In the sack and ties, the lady loped. Her stricken groom held to her side. And how the court of Camelot in terror stood, and horrified their sickened faces sought to hide. Perhaps they of their sovereign hoped King Arthur he would so decide that peerless Sir Gawain should not be forced to wedlock sanctified this loathsome damsel for his bride. The dress could not be found would fit the twist and falling of her shape, nor cover modestly her back, the tangle rising to her nape, grey silver as the fabled ape. Nor any crown or bonnet sit, concealing net or veiling drape upon her head, to hide the stack of sprouted warts, or drooled escape of dribble from her toothy gape. And no respite could any have, through scented cloth or basil leaf, no incense flung from holy urn, nor perfume offer aught relief from smells that rose behind her teeth. The dark and blister-bounded cave, all lipped about with bruising beef, emitted forth enough to churn a dragon's gut. A breathless thief of hope and dearest held belief. At service end, the throng's relief, coldly wed to retching grief. The dame had hoped the wretched king upon the road in dire quest, had told the secret keenly sought, the answer that would save his crest. What is it women love the best? Arthur's charge was find the thing that women may desire most, a treasure that might not be bought, the answer he had never guessed. He gave the wish she from him pressed, the boon he granted, much distressed, a husband held against her breast. Forlorn the king had faced his court, and spoke his obligation clear, the oath regretted, rashly made, a knight betrothed within the year, the monstrous damsel drawing near. Though many had with ogres fought and trolls, their faces stretched with fear to see the visage of the maid, the dangling eye, the pallor drear, the waxen tresses in her ear, the scabrous nose, the greasy smear of snot, the ghastly remnant leer. A silence fell, a latent jeer, a grimace hid, a court severe. My lady sat upon his knees, Gawain alone, his face sincere. If it will make thee glad and please, before my friends and brethren here, wilt take me, lady, for thy dear. A bath of water warm was near to bathe her face, her thigh, her feet, and pliers brought to trim her nail, and shears to prune her thatching neat, all hung with courtly smiles sweet. From eyes they wiped the rheumy tear, and sharing glances so discreet, flicked eyelids at her stubborn tail, while snatching stories to repeat when scaring husbands from their meat. At Queen's command, they made retreat, just Guinevere left to turn the sheet. And gazing at her counterpane, the face that naught of beauty had, a maiden on her wedding night, in tremors of unknowing clad, waiting silent for her lad. She shared her then a smile sad, and left her with a good night bad. We lay at first 100 breaths, my bulk and him upon the bed, untouching, stiff upon our backs, two pious statues of the dead, and neither one would raise our head. Then, like one in unhappy death, he turned and in the darkness said, my lady wife, a marriage lacks unless with closeness it is fed and layers of cold distance shed. His hand of power firm and red, he lay then on my skin of dread. 100 breaths we further lay, his hand and warmth upon my side, like a golden sun in heat of day, upon my tanned and leathered hide, the shadows of my pox denied. In time I felt a ripple play, uncalled for, like a turning tide, as winter fallow come to May, and yearning with deep terror vied within my belly, sagging wide. My lady wife, might you abide my shy embrace, my tender pride. Around me then he wrapped his arm, stretching to the furthest reach, and did not shy from holding firm this sea cow stranded on a beach, this slimy and blood-guzzled leech. Then for 100 breaths this warm and shaggy limb a ragged breach within me made, an eager worm to touch a bruised and mottled peach, an answer to my torn beseech. His mouth began a song to teach, a music plucked from each by each. I felt his kiss upon my cheek, breath playing on my whiskers there, I shuddered out my 100th gasp, thundered longing mixed with fear, and then upon my griffin's beak he lay a keen, unflinching stare, summoned an unyielding grasp, brushed aside the straying hair that moles had flung into the air, and leaned his golden smile near. My blisters raked across his lip, my spittle smeared upon his chin, my toothy gaping found his tongue, my clammy fingers found his skin, my bosom wrinkled in his grip, his pinch upon my nipple thin, and where my folding belly hung, he ran his hands beneath, within, 100 breaths, and so begin, my lord, my husband, enter in.
Thank you.
sunshine makes the bleakest waste seem beautiful. The giving light reflecting on the sharpest thorn. But nothing so awoke my sight as dawned upon our wedding night. Still half in sleep, I gently traced the edges of her forehead bright, all care and trepidation shorn, free of nervousness and fright, dispelled by troth in mutual plight. Her soft enchantment held me quite, I reached again and pulled her tight. She lay there still, as fair as any giant's wife, or white of May, and slept a slumber fathoms deep beneath the careful waves of day, till waking sloughed it all away. Then, leaping upright, fraught with many fears, she cried. He made assay to calm her, heard his lady weep, great heaving boulders of dismay, stones of sorrow jagged lay. My wife, may I your grief allay? Wherefore this curse of sorrow, pray? Who gave this curse? A witch, perhaps? My father's wife? I cannot tell. With malice held in looks and lies, who, clad in secret, spoke the spell and caused my body first to swell to awkward curves, abhorrent paps, with fur and unrelenting smell and skin that, as the desert, dries in dunes and stretches, rough as shell of crabs within the cockle's well. Beneath enchantment forced to dwell, a troglodyte and creature fell. With all endearments to repel, my face become my sentinel. The ringing of the wedding bell alone to bring the riot's quell. By wedding me, the spell you've broke in two, and only half remains. That half of time, in seeming fair, I'll walk the court and, free of chains, can dance to music's kind refrains. But list, the last enchantment spoke that half of time my beauty drains to furrowed looks and pitch despair, to tattered skin and angry veins, the target of the court's disdains. The glamour's force my choice constrains to bow to that your wisdom deigns. My husband, you have pledged to take and hold me safe despite my mien, or coat of sense, or lumbered form. The worst now of my body seen, I fear the best already been. The choice is left for you to make. By day, a fair and lovely queen, as slender as the forest fawn, to glad the court, to flaunt and preen. But come to bed, a thing obscene. Or would you, for our marriage sake, to keep your flinted fire keen, within our chamber, soft and warm, a beauty hid by the starlight sheen, but loathly go from dawn to e'en? A hundred breaths or more he stood and gazed into her stormy eye, now clear, now clouded, black, then blue, poised to let hard lightnings fly and crack apart the blistered sky with roaring thunder, sundering flood, and rage of hail. Or else to cry her only worth, her marriage rue. Both fair and foul within her vie, all joy and horror in her sigh. Which answer would his love belie? What doom to dwell in his reply? The shining of your heart imbues my nighted life with richest hues. And yet, to state my own confuse, it saddens me, the light should lose, would have me pitied through the day by each the pretty queens of May, or set me butted in their games, their fearful laughter at my shame, to bear the scorn and earn the blame of every jealous lord and dame, that I should curse the kind Gawain, to blight his joy and kindle pain. My hopes of freedom burnt in vain, and I tormented once again. I would not have my words obtuse, nor leave you fated to abuse, for all a jealous witch's ruse should make the smallest side glance bruise, to cage me with the sun instead, in fear of nightfall's heavy tread. My beauty by the starlight bled, and all the love of daytime fled. To reach our chamber door with dread, my shape undone and beauty shed, to find within a greasy bed my husband's ardour lying dead. Better to have ne'er been wed than have these furies in my head, nor have you so imprisoned. A flaunted thing, or clipped recluse? My answer must remain unsaid. He is no knight who would reduce the freedom of the one he woos. Your beauty, when and where to use, beloved, 'tis for you to choose. Silence then, a ringing still as foxes hear the hare's breath held, a wary and expectant while she stood there like a giant felled, and gleaming as an oyster shelled, a pearl unfeeling, tearless, till like sunlight through a mist dispelled, a radiance broke out through her smile, through her eyes a beauty welled, and all her native grace beheld, the curse removed, the truth expelled, that beauty full within her dwelled. The thing that women desire most, 'tis said, is but to have our way, but more, to feel we own a voice, and it be heard, that each can say that this is who I am today. My sovereignty will not be lost to any earless husband's sway. Your gentle heeding of my choice, through storming of my heart's dismay, has torn the curse's teeth away. I choose in fairness to remain for always with my kind Gawain.